All right. Our next speaker then is Mark Leach from Cobalt Solutions, talking about drone detection and tracking in urban environments. Mark?
Thanks, Charles. Yes, I'm excited to talk about the capability that we're developing for drone detection in urban environments, and I think it could be of real value to first responders. We've all, probably think that we've seen some pretty cool footage from drones, and they are great technology, lots of fun to fly and for kids and stuff like that. But I think the news out of the Ukraine war would convince anyone that they're also literally a weapon and a threat. And even when they're not weaponized, they can be a nuisance or a concern. I remember I was at a concert at Austin City Limits Music Festival a few years ago at night, and there's a drone flying over the crowd. And I'm thinking, is that drone supposed to be here? Are they authorized to be here? What are they doing? Are they taking footage? Are they recording the show? And I know first responders such as yourselves get tagged with these problems. What is that drone? Is it a threat? What are we going to do about it? And especially now with the new drones that we're hearing from Turkey and elsewhere, they're silent, stealthy, cheap. It's a real problem. So the very place where we're concerned about is the problems where a lot of people such as yourself are concerned about, where there's a lot of people at stadiums, at concerts, people trying to cross the Brooklyn Bridge to go get a pizza. This is where drones over these kind of environments create a lot of concern for people that are in charge of these venues, for law enforcement, for security providers. So that's where the problem sits. It's not like there's not good technology out there today. There really is some good technology. The problem is in those environments and in that urban environment, they don't always fit well for various reasons. For example, there's some great radar technology out there that does a good job for tracking certain kinds of drones, but it would be hard to put those radars in an urban environment. They're expensive to scale up. They have the same problems with blockage and everything that anything else would have. The other problem with the radar is, first of all, there's a safety issue. You're broadcasting a high-powered signal around a bunch of people. There's also a licensing issue. You have to get permission to operate at these different frequencies. And certainly at the higher frequencies I'm going to talk about, those licenses don't exist anymore. The telcos like Verizon and T-Mobile have gobbled all those up for 5G, which I'll talk about why that matters to this project in a second. But the other problem with radars is a bunch of radars are going to interfere with each other. And that's the biggest problem with trying to network a bunch of radars together. So interference, and licensing and other things make it harder for radars to do this job. Cameras and lasers are cool technology. They can do a lot of good stuff. However, cameras create a privacy concern, especially around a bunch of people that don't want their picture taken. Lasers create a safety concern. And these systems don't work well when it's dark or hazy or raining. And a lot of times they can't scan quickly or get a very good range to a drone target. There are some really good systems that exploit the RF link, the link between the guy controlling the drone and the drone itself. And they can tell you where he is and where the drone is. That's awesome. But the problem is some of these new drones aren't using a link. They're just taking the GPS coordinate of the target and flying to the target or using computer vision to fly to the target. So you can't exploit the link. So there are some gaps in the current capabilities. We've been talking to people in first responders and people that are worried about drones and trying to gather what are their concerns and what are their requirements. And they're all have collapsed into the list that I've put on here today. But at the end of the talk, if I hear about new requirements or new concerns, I'd love to capture those from you. Pretty much everybody we talked to first responders in charge of critical infrastructure in New York. We talked to people in Austin and elsewhere in Texas. We talked to people in the DC area. They want stuff that's easy to use, safe. It's got to be safe. It's got to respect privacy, especially now people are very concerned about privacy. There's legal implications for privacy. They can't deal with these frequency licenses that take too long to get or giant permitting headaches trying to get gear installed or deployed. And they need something that's easy to deploy, rugged, work in the environment. Another problem that people told us that drives them crazy is false alarms. When a system is telling them it's a drone, but it's really just another Wi-Fi link or a vehicle or something like that. So they need high probability of detection and a low false alarm rate. Everyone wants that. And they need a good fix on the target. They need to know where it is and if they have a way to counter that drone, fly another drone to take it down or a weapon of some kind, they need to have a good estimate of where the drone is if they're going to do something about it. So this is what we want to talk about, what we're building. So we've all heard about 5G rolling out, and it's going to be good technology ultimately. It's not as maybe as great as they're promising, but it's got a lot of interesting capabilities, especially this different bands that it's operating at. And we're interested in the band that's up at the high band. It's called the millimeter wave band, because that will give us a chance to really detect these drones with that signal. The great thing about leveraging the 5G towers as a passive radar for drone detection is the base stations are already deployed. We don't have to get all the permitting. We don't have to worry about how we're going to deploy them and power them and all that stuff. They're already out there, and they provide high-speed connectivity to move data around, so we get that for free. They've already been designed to so that they don't interfere with each other, right? I talked about interference being a problem with radars. Well, the Verizon and T-Mobile want to make money when you're talking or chatting or texting or downloading or uploading videos. So they've already made sure that your phone's going to work in all the environments it's working in. So the interference problem, well, we don't have to worry about. And again, they're operating at millimeter wave, which gives us a chance to find these very difficult to detect drones. With regular radars, people go, well, what kind of coverage does it have? What kind of range do I get? With passive radar using 5G, you really just have to ask, what kind of 5G coverage do I have in the area I care about? You know, it doesn't matter if this tower or that tower illuminates the drone. I just need to know I have 5G in the area of interest. So let me talk a little bit about why we are so excited about millimeter wave. It is literally up at, 24 gigahertz and above the frequency. I mean, the wavelength is down at the few millimeter range, so you can find what would be stealthy to other signals you can find with a millimeter wave radar. You're already using this technology, whether you realize it or not. It's in your car. It's doing the collision avoidance, pedestrian detection, bicycle detection, things like that. It's also being used to detect people now, again, because of the privacy concerns. We have these in Austin. They took down the traffic cameras, but they do have millimeter wave radars at the intersection. You know, they don't take a picture of your face. They're just measuring how much activity is there. Is there a lot of traffic? Is there a big clog there? Or they're tracking people movement, you know, at the entrance to subways and things like that. But they haven't been adapted to the drone problem. And that's what Cobalt is trying to do. We're trying to adapt millimeter wave radar and 5G to the drone problem, and essentially get a 5G radar for free. You know, it's illuminating the drones, and we don't have to mess with that. So how does it work to get a fix on the drone? It sounds complicated, but it's really not that difficult. Actually, passive radar has been around for a long time, since World War II. They were using radio waves, you know, from FM radio and things like that to track airliners and things like that. But if you look at the little purple circle that's got the beams radiating out of it, that represents a 5G base station that's broadcasting signals out to your phone. The little blue circle represents our Cobalt sensor that's collecting those signals in real time. And the little red or orange circle represents a drone. What we do is we measure the path difference between the direct range from the tower to our sensor and the reflected or scattered path from the tower to the drone to our sensor. And that creates an ellipse. Somewhere along that ellipse is where the drone has to be based on the path difference, the relative range between us and the drone and the tower. But we also have a phased array on the sensor that allows us to precisely determine the angle of arrival. So we intersect the angle of arrival on this ellipse, and that's how we get the position of the drone. What are some of the benefits and features of our capability versus other things? I've talked about this a little bit, and I'm not trying to be negative about other systems. They all have very good things in some cases. But in the urban environment, you know, we can be all weather. We can operate at night, so that's not a concern. We're completely passive. There's no safety or privacy concerns. Again, no licensing concerns. We don't have to worry about that. Again, I mentioned safety. That's a big one. We're not radiating, so there's no issue there. Because we're leveraging the trillions of dollars that they put into 5G and the phone that's in your pocket, components that used to be super expensive are getting very, very affordable. We can build 5G technology for pennies on the dollar of what it would have been 10 years ago, thanks to the explosion of 5G. So that means we can make something affordable. Again, because we're operating at millimeter wave, we can get the kind of accuracy that we need. We can find stealthy drones. And it doesn't matter to us whether you have a link or you don't have a link. We don't use a link, so that's fine with us. So what are we doing with this project? Where does it stand? We've been working on the effort for about a year. We have a phase two SBIR with the Department of Homeland Security. We're in the middle of testing right now. We've been testing in the Austin area against live 5G signals and drones that we're flying, things like a DJI Phantom and DJI Mavic, and we're getting good results. We're really excited. And we started to think about what the product's going to look like, and I'll talk about that in a couple slides. Here's a picture of today's sensor. This isn't what the product would look like, but just so that you can see what we're testing with now, we just put something together with off-the-shelf components. You can see the little gold horn antennas. That's the phased array that collects the signal and measures the angle of arrival. It's being operated by a little battery pack that we got off Amazon, a little Jackery battery pack connected to a laptop that gives us the radar scope and results. The 5G base station is circled in red there, and I tried to blow it up. It's just a small little panel. It's not like the big macro cell that you used to see. It's a small little panel. In fact, it's so small you can't really make it out real well, but that's the thing that's illuminating the drone. And again, we're out there testing with this thing over the last few weeks and have been really happy with the initial results that we're getting, again, against things like a DJI Phantom and a DJI Mavic, you know, on the rooftops of buildings and things like that. The ultimate product, we put some effort into designing what it will look like for someone like yourselves. And think of something that's completely sealed and fairly ruggedized, that's kind of a skinny ream of paper, you know, 10 by 6 by 1.5, weighs less than 20 pounds. Again, we're using all the modern 5G millimeter wave componentry that's in your phone to be able to make a more sophisticated processing and collection box that will still be affordable for people such as yourselves. This thing could be mounted on a tripod, it could be mounted on a pole, the same way that you would mount the towers themselves. Wherever it's passive, it's low power, it'll use less than 50 watts. We believe we can run this thing for 20 hours or more on one of these little Jackery batteries, which we've even done with the big sensor, the prototype that we've done so far. Again, there's no forced air cooling, no fans, so it'll operate all weather. We'll have no standard connectors on there. So essentially, it should be pretty well designed for the kinds of environments that you'd want to take it out and use it for. What's going to happen at the end of this project? Where are we going with this technology? Of course, we're using the SBIR and our own investment to develop the capability and the product. At the end of this project with DHS, we will have demonstrated that we can detect and track a small UAV in an urban environment using live 5G signals. And I'm pretty confident that we'll check that box since we're doing it to a degree already today. But of course, everyone wants their system to fit into their larger system of systems. I mean, DHS has a system of systems. You probably have a command center or some other master system that you want your data feeding into. And obviously, we all have to work together to solve these kinds of problems. So they want us to make sure that our system will be interoperable with the other things they have. And of course, we're committed to that. So in summary of the capability, we're leveraging 5G millimeter wave base stations as an illuminating radar to track drones in urban environments. And we think that it's going to be an exciting capability to affordably turn 5G into a threat detection system, kind of a dual use technology for people such as yourself. In terms of first responders, we have talked to some first responders. Of course, you're always going to benefit from talking to real users and getting the hard questions that they have. So we'd love to hear some questions, love to learn more about what's important to you. We're looking for opportunities to try to do some testing with the first responder community later this year when we've, you know, sort of finalized this project and we have something we can take out and test routinely. And if you're interested in keeping up with what's going on with the project, we'd love to be able to give you updates and talk about where we're heading with the product development. So at that point, I can stop here and see if there's any questions or if there's anything else that people would like to learn. Small company, we started in 2020, right before pandemic. We're focused on 5G applications. We'd love to hear what you think.
All right. Thank you very much, Mark. If you want, could you put your contact slide up? Perfect. All right. Looks like we have some questions coming in. So just again, as a reminder, either type them in the Q&A box, or if you're unable to access that or you have questions later, you can reach out to their contact information there. First question then is, what if there's no millimeter wave available in our designated area of interest?
So that's a good question. It's a very fair question. Right now, we are focused on millimeter wave because it's the best signal. However, you might have heard that they just authorized the C-band transmission for 5G, which is down around the between three and four gigahertz. And that's a very clean signal that we would love to explore. We think it'll work, perhaps not as good as millimeter wave, but that will be everywhere. You know, they were in a little bit of fight with the FAA to whether they could get full authorization for that, but that got cleared up. So the C-band 5G would be the answer for people that aren't in the dense urban environment or don't have the regular millimeter wave yet.
All right, and that might address another question that came in that asks, will it work with the macro cells? Thinking more rural areas that won't see 5G micro cells for quite a while.
Right, that's where we're saying the C-band. Again, we haven't tested with the C-band. We've only done modeling and simulation, but we're really excited about it. But that would be the answer for the more rural areas.
All right, perfect. Next question then is, how do you differentiate a drone from other objects?
Well, you know, we're doing testing right now. Of course, it's partly dependent on several things. The radar cross-section of the drone, once you sort of calibrate for what those look like, you can use the radar cross-section itself to say that looks more like a drone. There's also the behavior of the target, you know. But, and there's a lot of people that have done some very sophisticated tracking and artificial intelligence back-end processing to say this is a bird, this is a drone, this is a vehicle. What we've seen so far is it's pretty easy to distinguish big things like vehicles and people from the drone. I think the harder things would be if a bird and a drone are right in the same place, can you detect it? That's going to take a little more work.
All right, great. Next question then is, how do you know if you have enough 5G coverage density?
Well, if you've got, there's websites. If you have an area of interest, like where we're going to do some testing, hopefully New York, we're going to do a survey up there. We have the ability to determine if you've got the needed coverage there. Another thing is, if your phone itself goes into high band mode, or it'll say ultra wide band or something like that, that means you've got the millimeter wave. But we can evaluate. There's websites that sort of tell you where the millimeter wave is, and we also, our system itself can. First thing it does is survey the area to make sure you've got enough coverage.
All right, perfect. Next question then is, how do you determine specific placement of your sensors? Incident event based, for example?
I think the first thing would be to put it where you are trying to get the coverage area. You know, you've got a threat area that you need covered. That's what drive it. But we have software. Our CTO came out of the 5G industry, and they developed the same stuff that they developed. Where do we put the towers? We're going to use that same very sophisticated modeling software to say, where do we put the sensor that gives us the best chance to cover a certain area you care about?
All right, great. And I think this will be the last question based on time. He says, or they ask, unless you're one of very few three-letter agencies or the Department of Defense, you can't interdict the drone. Need location of the operator. Can you project estimate a operator location with your system?
No, I mean, today we're focused on where the drone is, and because we don't know anything about the operator, that's not what our system can tell you.
All right, but it would be then whoever's using yours system would then integrate that into other. All right, perfect. All right, Mark, well, thank you very much. Great discussion.